Hello, everybody.
We need to make this one quick. I'm trying to get out of here and do some turkey hunting this afternoon.
Takes one to find one.
Yeah, that's right. So here we are. We're going to discuss a little bit about Jehovah's Witnesses and their urban legends.
Yeah, we got to talking about this the other night. So we started making a list of Jehovah's Witness urban legends.
Urban legend number one. Do Jehovah's Witnesses shun?
No, they don't shun. Do they protect pedophiles?
Oh, no, they don't protect them.
They don't lie in court.
That's a huge urban legend. They will not lie before a court judge.
Yeah. 1975, it's all the publisher's imagination.
Yeah. Watchtower never said the end was going to come. That's an urban legend, yeah. People.
This generation will not pass away. Another one of those urban legends.
Urban legends. But I'm telling you, these urban legends with Jehovah's Witnesses run deep, don't they?
Yeah, no wonder witnesses are so upset about, you know, all these apostates spreading all these lies all over the place.
Yes, because they're accusing us of spreading urban legends.
Yeah. Millions now living will never die.
Whoa. That has to be changed.
Millions now living may never die,
but I'm going to change it. Millions that were living back then did die. Oh, but that's an urban legend.
Oh, now this is a good one. Now this is back in the olden days. Vaccinations cause disease. Oh, this is a good one. Shepherds really care about you.
Yeah, you know, until you get a 22-page letter, you know, defaming you.
Yeah, slandering you, and they don't even come and ask you.
Yep.
Right, sweetie? Love you. They're the only true religion on earth.
That's the biggest crock of slick shit I've ever heard.
Oh, and witnesses disfellowship themselves, and it's only for serious sins.
Wow, what a bunch of urban legends. But there's one more urban legend that we're going to have to talk about.
Have you got the blood booklet again?
I have the blood booklet, friends, and this is what this whole video is about.
I think he has way too much fun with this blood booklet.
Well, the thing is like I said in the previous video, you know, it seems like we're all spending our time debunking the nonsense from Russell, Rutherford, and Franz, and the governing body today, but everybody seems to be skipping our old brother Nor, you know. Oh, excuse me. God rest his soul.
Yeah.
So what I want to do is I want to go back to page 9, and then I'm going to go to page 33 and get into some more nonsense.
Now, I do have the PDF if anybody wants this booklet.
Yes. You know, as Jehovah's Witnesses, and even more so in our modern day, when those Twilight movies started coming out about the vampires and the werewolves.
Oh, they seem to have a lot of vampire werewolf movies
coming
out. Yeah,
you know, and Watchtower portrays all that as being part of the occult, and in some aspects it probably truly is. But, you know, Watchtower is using that stuff as, you got to stay away from it. Because, you know, the demons will come into your life.
It's demonic.
It's demonic and all this kind of stuff. Exactly. So they build this fear. They build
urban
this
legend.
Hatred for this sort of stuff. But let's look and see how Watchtower has built the fear and the hatred of blood transfusions or blood products or animals that are not properly strangled. Now, remember, friends, this was published in 1960, and just listen to how graphic this is. Page 9,
first paragraph,
obedience of early Christians. By their obedience to God's law requiring abstinence from blood, early Christians stood out in contrast to the world around them. It is reported that ancient Egyptian princes bathed in human blood for rejuvenation. Other men would greedily devour flesh that had been freshly slashed from a living animal. Well, that sounds like what a werewolf would do, or maybe even a zombie.
Yeah.
Considering it a delicacy, because it was still quivering with life and dripping with blood. Well, isn't that what vampires do? Don't they bite the neck and they suck the blood as the body quivers?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we go on.
You know, this is worse than any...
Oh, yeah.
You know, teenage novel or movie or anything. This is horrible.
But remember, this was printed in 1960.
This is horrible.
Treaties were made by some peoples by cutting their arms and presenting the gashes to each other to draw out some of the blood by mouth.
Vampires.
Spectators at the Roman gladiatorial contest would even rush into the arena to suck the blood from the vanquished gladiators, supposing they might thereby acquire the strength of the dying man. What a contrast to the Christian respect for the sanctity of life.
And what's interesting is, there's no scriptures, but they have a little four that you can do for reference. And you go to the back, and you see number four, and they have a reference listed here. Tertullian's Apology, GP, September 1960, page 127. And we printed that Tertullian's Apology up, and we read that page, and he's talking about, you know, comparing Christians to how they wouldn't fight, you know, and all of this, and then, you know, he called them pagans. But, I mean, none of this graphic, gory stuff is in this Tertullian's Apology.
Well, it may be, but it's not in the section that Watchtower is referring to on this particular page.
Yeah, it is not on page 127.
And this is what Kim and I found so ironic when we did a little bit of research regarding Tertullian. This man, some considered to be the first true Christian apologist, but he's also the one that developed the Trinity doctrine. You know, the one that Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe in because it's false teachings. But yet Jehovah's Witnesses, how come you go to the door and destroy a false teaching, but yet the same very man prints this and you use it as if it's historical fact? My goodness. Noah was a total nut job.
And then you throw away his, you know, theology about the Trinity.
Yeah, my goodness.
Talk about cherry picking.
Yeah, my goodness. Well, but we know that that's what Watchtower's famous for.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're a cult. This is what cults do. This is how cults operate.
Or is that an urban legend?
That's an urban legend.
I don't think you're going
turkey hunting. It's starting to snow and rain on the mountain. I'm not going turkey hunting. So guess what, folks? You're going to have to put up with me a little bit longer.
It's starting to snow on the mountain here.
Yes. You're going to enjoy my company for a little bit longer now. Yeah, you're right. I'm not going turkey hunting.
He ain't going turkey hunting.
Okay, so now...
maybe you can expose turkeys here.
Yeah, I can expose some turkeys here. All right. This is where it gets interesting. But before I do that, I want to go to the reasoning book, and I want to read some things from the reasoning book under the subheading or the topic or the chapter on soul.
A good one.
And I'm going to quote from a quote. Watchtower, in this particular quote I'm going to read comes from the Presbyterian Life, May 1st, 1970, page 35.
He is on the Reasoning in the Scriptures book, page 379.
Yep.
Under the subheading, "What is the origin of Christendom's belief in an immaterial, immortal soul?"
And then they also quote from the Religion of Babylonia and Assyria, Boston, 1898, by M. Jastrow, Jr., page 556. Now, this is what Watchtower pulls out of these two magazines to confirm that the existence of a soul outside the body is false teachings. Okay? This is what the Presbyterian Life says. "Immortality of the soul is a Greek notion formed in ancient mystery cults and elaborated by the philosopher Plato." So that's what Watchtower pulled out of that magazine to show that the whole theory of the immortal soul comes from mystery cult, ancient mystery cult, and also comes from the philosopher
Greek
Plato.
Philosophy.
Greek philosophy. And then the other one from the Babylonian, the Religion of Babylonia and Assyria, this is what Watchtower pulls out. "The problem of brutality we have seen engaged the serious attention of the Babylonian theologists.
Dot, dot, dot.
Yeah. Neither the people nor the leaders of religious thought ever faced the possibility of the total annihilation of what once was called into existence. Death was a passage to another kind of life.
So witnesses do not believe that there is a soul that exists beyond the body.
But you know, the thing is Watchtower prints this slick crap.
Making me dizzy again.
Without even giving any thought. I dropped my glasses.
Well, at least you didn't poke your eye.
I don't poke my eye. But they don't give any thought or any level of comprehension to what they're writing and who they're quoting and what's being said in the quote. Okay? So I'm going to read on page 33, the second paragraph. Now, just to put this into context, the preceding few pages are talking about diseases that are transmitted through blood transfusion, such as
hepatitis,
malaria. And we all know that in the modern day AIDS, that's almost a tongue twister, that AIDS was, transmitted pretty readily and pretty widely spread through blood transfusions.
Well, this is from 1960-61, right. So it was pre-AIDS scare.
Yeah, but Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe in a soul that exists outside of the human body. Well, then Jehovah's Witnesses, how would you explain this one? Now remember, in context, it's talking about diseases that are being transmitted through blood transfusions. These facts cover only a limited number of dangers of blood transfusion. There are also at hand reports from doctors showing that numerous other disorders, including cancer, the tendency to insanity, may be transmitted by blood. Reports from doctors in both North and South America show that, here it comes, personality traits have also been altered, that formerly clean-cut individuals who have been transfused with the blood of criminals and sex perverts have been changed into degenerates. Surely the dangers of blood transfusions cannot be overemphasized.
Okay, so let me... I know, I'm reading it, and I'm no dummy, but a clean-cut person who is transfused with blood from a criminal and sex pervert changed into these degenerates.
So, Watchtower does believe that the soul survives outside the body. Because if you received a blood transfusion from a criminal or a sex pervert, then you will have been changed into the same deviant person that you received the blood from.
And I know in your conversation with our conversation with Deep Throat this morning, you know, the subject of liver transplants came up.
Yeah.
Now, we know that they cannot clean every single little drop of the liver before they transplant it into another person. And the liver is what cleans your blood. So it is cleansing your soul, you know. So if you give someone a liver transplant, does that mean a part of your soul goes into them?
But according to Watchtower's teaching, you are the soul. You don't have a soul that survives outside your body.
But so, no, this does not make sense, because from what they're saying, a part of your soul that is in the blood, and like we had in our very first video, you know, a fraction of your soul goes with your blood to, you know, be into that person. So, Watchtower, you do believe that the soul can leave your body and go into another person.
Because if a blood transfusion can change the personality or even make somebody have tendencies to insanity, then that person's blood, the soul that's in the blood, is causing this, and that person's soul is now taking over the other person's body, causing them to have tendencies to insanity, causing them to become, formerly clean-cut individuals who have been transfused with the blood of criminals and sex addicts. So that soul from the criminal or the sex addict now is left the body of the criminal and the sex addict and now dwells and is still alive in the other body. So you do believe that a soul survives outside the body.
It does exist.
So, Jehovah's Witnesses, why can you not read this stuff and comprehend how Watchtower doesn't have a clue what they're talking about?
Well, see, this is what happens when you leave and your mind becomes clearer and you're not under that cult mind control. Guess what? You're able to reason these things out and think about it. It's like, wait a minute. You know, just like in our first video, if you take your blood and transfuse it into another person, they said, you know, you cannot be whole soul because you've given a part of your soul
you
with the blood to this person. Okay, so then that means you do believe in a part of the soul that can leave your body.
See, and here's something else you should ponder, Jehovah's Witnesses. When you look at life, life doesn't always have to be a living entity such as a human being or an animal. Life could be something else. We all know that Watchtower is doing cartoons with Caleb and Sophia. They make those inanimate objects come
cartoon
to life.
Figures.
Those cartoon figures affect the mind growth
of the kids.
Of the child. So in a very real essence, in a very real scenario, the life of those cartoons are now affecting your children. So life really can take on many different forms. And since life is the soul, soul is the life, the governing body, your governing body, has a soul all of its own. And they are projecting that soul into your life. In fact, at the beginning of this, we talked about urban legends. You go to JW.org, the soul of the governing body says, we don't shun. But every disfellowship Jehovah Witness knows for an absolute fact, you do shun. The soul, the life of the governing body says, we don't protect pedophiles. But you know damn well that if a pedophile takes a young child into an isolated room and does his hideous deeds, there's not two witnesses. So your rules, the soul of your rules protects the pedophile. The soul of your governing body doesn't lie in court, but yet didn't Garrett Loesch lie in court? I don't control the day-to-day operations of Watchtower.
That was in his deposition.
That's an absolute... Do you see the soul? Do you see the life that Watchtower is projecting onto you, Jehovah's Witnesses? This whole 1975 crap. I lived through it. I saw what Watchtower was doing with my education. Oh, don't go educated because... We're not going to be in this system long enough for you to even use that education. Do you see what that life of Watchtower did to a lot of us? This generation will not pass away. Here's that soul
it's in action.
That generation is dead and gone. But that soul, that life that comes from Watchtower says, oh, now the generations are overlapping. Do you see how that life, that soul of Watchtower is still projecting its intentions onto you? Don't worry about a blood transfusion ruining your relationship with God. You need to worry about what these knuckleheads are doing to you and how that affects your relationship with God and Christ.
From what we're seeing, you know, on this side, because we talk to people who have been abused and shunned and everything constantly. You know, we talk to so many of these people, so we're seeing it from this side. We can see the soul of Watchtower from the governing body and headquarters. We see nothing but evil and black hearts and no empathy or fellow feeling for what they are doing to families and individuals.
Yeah. How many of you current Jehovah's Witnesses know somebody that was a Jehovah's Witness that committed suicide? I think we can all raise our hands on that. Yeah. That's the soul. That's the life of Watchtower. That's what this soul, Watchtower's soul, is doing to you. How many of you Jehovah's Witnesses are taking happy pills, Prozac, mind-altering drugs, whatever you want to call it, just so that you can find a level of happiness that apparently the soul of Watchtower is not giving to you? Wake up! There's more involved than this crap right here.
Yeah. So we will be back, hopefully, with some more from this booklet.
Oh, I'm there's 60-something pages to it, and I'm only up to page 33, so I got some more to go.
Yes. And I just happened to have found the hardback copy of Kingdom of the Cults. And so I've been reading this. And what's interesting about this is, you know, it's not produced by Watchtower. Someone else wrote it. And he's got lots of letters after his name, a PhD and all of this. But it's interesting, he discusses all of these religions which he views are cults. And it's funny because Jehovah's Witnesses has the largest section in here.
Yeah.
Some of these religions only have 20 pages. Watchtower has way over 100 pages, and so I'm reading that. So lots of research to do, and back at work.
So thanks for watching, and Jehovah's Witnesses, if you have any questions regarding any of this, please feel free to contact us at watchtower.exposed.
Yes, and you all have a great weekend.
Bye.